Macmillan Australia Audio and Belinda present this unabridged recording of Our Sunburnt Country, written and read by Dr. Anika Molesworth. I acknowledge the Aboriginal people of the place I call home and recognise their continuing connection to land, water, animals, plants and culture. I pay my respect to the Willikali people and the elders past, present and emerging. I also extend that respect to all First Peoples in Australia and around the world, and celebrate their enduring relationships to their homes and honour the value of their knowledge and stories that help us create a brighter future together. To my family, who are my home. Prologue. For me, food is about family. It's the delicious, steaming meals that bring us around the table together and connect me to my home. Not only because home is where I cook and share stories around the kitchen table, but because my home also produces food. My family's farm is located in one of the most beautiful and fragile places of Australia, in far western New South Wales. It's a landscape of endless sapphire blue sky, ancient trees twisted by the years, and unique beady-eyed creatures that live among them. Red sand horizons stretch out forever and set the stage for the most spectacular sunrises, swirling all the colours of an artist's palette. Here we raise sheep on rugged ranges and over flat grass country. The animals graze in a quiet broken only occasionally by the swoosh of a passing flock of ruby-flecked parrots. My home fills me with awe and wonder every day, and is a place to which I feel a great sense of belonging and responsibility to look after. Although everyone has some interest in the weather, if it is rainy or warm and sunny outdoors, for farmers, nothing is more important to their way of life. Temperature and rainfall guide decisions such as when to sow and harvest crops, and how much water is available to grow grain and for livestock to drink. Our way of life is embedded deeply in our environment. So it is understandable that there is growing concern now that things are changing. Natural rhythms and seasonal cycles are no longer acting as they once did. Nature is breaking down around us. These observations are backed up by science. The evidence is clear. As a global society, we have emitted dangerous greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, trapping heat and increasing global temperatures. In doing so, we have thrown the climate system into chaos and the food system into harm's way. As farmers live and work so closely with the natural world, we are some of the first to feel the true impacts of climate change. Hotter temperatures are directly associated with heatwaves and bushfires, while greater evaporation dries out soils and causes heart-wrenching droughts. More moisture in the atmosphere increases rain and flooding intensity by fueling the rage of storms and cyclones. Crop and livestock diseases are spreading, worsening animal welfare and food's nutritional value. These disruptions have impacted what type of food farmers can produce and where. Around the globe, mounting food and livelihood insecurities are now driving mass rural to urban migration, exacerbating poverty and inequalities in the most vulnerable and important communities, that of our food producers. And, at the end of the day, the impacts of climate change on the farming community affect all of us, as we all eat food. Climate change threatens every meal on every plate. Over the past few decades, the world has changed immensely as a burgeoning global population has asked more and more of our common home. We have raised forests to make our coffee, mined precious minerals for the latest gadgets, snuffed out birdsong and humming insects for highways and honking, and have polluted our land, water, and skies as though consequences do not exist. The way we are devouring the planet is unsustainable. To highlight this, we need look no further than the food system. It is broken. Agriculture and associated land use consumes 75% of the water extracted from nature, occupies more than 30% of land surface, is a primary driver of biodiversity loss, and generates around 30% of human greenhouse gas emissions. Climate change is impacting what we eat, and what we eat is impacting climate change. For those of us in developed countries, food that is neither seasonal nor local travels thousands of kilometres and is smothered in plastic and chemicals to satisfy our insatiable appetites. Our bodies warn us to stop as medications and hospital admissions increase, but we continue to select high sugar, high salt, high fat, highly processed foods that defy nutritional recommendations. These resource-consuming, carbon-intense foods cripple our health, yet we stuff them in our mouths and demand them at the cheapest price. Any excess food is scraped into the bin, trashing precious finite resources and releasing gases of rotting, wasted food into our skies. And still we remain complacent, naively thinking that what we're doing can continue. Because there's food in the shops today, we believe that there will be tomorrow. But delusions of safety do not actually protect us. Reality has a way of catching up. And the food on our plates is at risk. Farm production, processing, transport, consumption, and waste define the global food system. Interactions are highly complex and connected, but the system isn't working. Today, 2 billion people are overweight or obese, while more than 800 million people in the world are hungry. 2 billion people suffer from micronutrient deficiencies, and a quarter of the world's children under the age of 5 are affected by stunting because they are not eating enough or the right kind of food. Meanwhile, perversely, enough food is wasted every year to feed 3 billion people. These statistics should make us feel unsettled in the stomach. Such troubles are hard to digest. So the question of our age has been laid on the table before us. How do we simultaneously achieve good health for people and our planet? The world is in a perilous state, and what we have lost and destroyed over the past few decades is inexcusable. Grief and frustration infect many of us. Yet it would be more inexcusable to give up, not to save and protect what can be. There is so much beauty and mystery in our world that deserves our care and respect. Our food system is fragile, and so is all the life that depends upon it, life that depends on us. Acknowledging the climate crisis and the responsibility it demands of us is not done lightly. And that's where courage comes into it. As global challenges erode the pillars of food security, its availability, access, utilization, and stability, we can choose to watch on as silent witnesses or find the inner strength to change our trajectory. What we do today will determine our tomorrow. Igniting hope and mobilizing people with better narratives towards an exciting vision is what's needed. Using our imaginations to redefine how our society interacts with the planet, harnessing traditional knowledge and employing innovative technologies will set us on a better path. These actions will help create a truly sustainable and climate-resilient food system that nourishes communities and regenerates landscapes. We can fill the leadership void by stepping out of our comfort zone, shifting mindsets, and inspiring behaviour change. Climate courage is the mental and moral strength to express our fears, challenge the status quo, and help bring to life the vision that we know is possible. That is my intention with this book. While the early chapters focus on my growing awareness of the climate crisis and sense of responsibility to do something about it, the book then turns the storytelling over to others who are doing what they can to look after their homes and our planet. As a listener, you will hear about the efforts from people all over the world, from farmers, scientists, chefs, nutritionists, and advocates who are striving to make the future the best it possibly can be. This book shares the story of the humanity entangled in the climate crisis throughout the food system. It portrays the connection of people to nature, explains why we are crossing Earth's boundaries and causing frightening damage, and how we as individuals can influence positive change and secure a better future for our world and all the precious life it holds. Ultimately, it is my hope that you will find knowledge, skills, inspiration, and courage from within these pages. The climate crisis is not imminent. It is here. And farmers like me are being challenged today. This concerns everyone who eats food. Now is the time that we must recognize that we are all problem makers and problem solvers. To look after the food system and create a better world, we must now cultivate climate courage. 1. Family. Food for the body is not enough. There must be food for the soul. Dorothy Day, Catholic worker, 1940. Her hands are as soft as silk and delicate as tissue paper. Flecked with pale sunspots and faded scars, they show they have worked hard in life. My fingertip traces the veins on the back of my grandmother's hands. She lounges on a tan, faux leather couch, distracted in conversation with my father about pruning the lemon tree in the garden. The tree is large and leafy, decorated with a bounty of golden orb fruit. Pruning it properly is important, she says, and no lemon should fall wasted to the ground. Kneeling on the linoleum-tiled floor, I rest against her legs, my gaze following her fingers that move like a conductor's baton, directing which branches can go and which must stay. Her warm hand lands back in my upturned palm. It's a strong grip, surprisingly tight for someone in her 80s. But for me, as a 7-year-old, it's a grip that always makes me feel secure. The best way to describe my grandmother is as a force. Her dark, captivating eyes could flash between humour to intent in an instant. Her wit cracked like a whip, and if you happened to be at the receiving end, you felt momentary shock and a sting before a playful glint in her eyes reassured you of her good intent. She wasn't the submissive type. Granny had a reputation of speaking her mind. On more than one occasion, she had stared down a police officer while shaking her walking stick and delivering a fierce reprimand when something hadn't quite played out the way she thought it should. On more than one occasion, I had peered around her ample waist to see the helpless police officer apologizing profusely and agreeing that my granny was entirely correct and, whatever the error was, it would never happen again. There was an intensity in her loyalty to family and friends, a protective nature where the sole reason for her every action seemed to be looking after the people in her care. This is perhaps a common trait of grandmothers, sweet as fresh cream, but with a lifetime of lessons ready to impart. Granny's small, red brick home was tucked behind my family's house in an unusually large and vegetated garden, perfumed by the scent of citrus flowers in bloom. The trees moaned when the wind blew strongly, but radiated birdsong when all was still. It was an oasis in suburbia, only a short train ride away from Melbourne's city centre. On weekends, my parents, two brothers and I tumbled through Granny's door, her quiet house erupting in a cacophony of noise as we grandkids scampered between rooms playing hide and seek. Tucking myself into a linen closet, I would stifle giggles as my elder brother padded down the hallway, imploring my parents to reveal which direction I had gone to hide. When the suspense was just too much, I would burst from my den, grab the outstretched arm of my younger brother, and we would sprint out into the garden with Granny's little ginger-coloured terrier, Binny, barking at our heels. I would wield a stick in the dog's direction and give a mighty hi-ya. Outside among the trees we would run, as fast as our toothpick legs would carry us. Slow down, Granny would call at our disappearing figures. You'll knock someone over. Shrill children's voices tangled with the dog's bark, cricket commentary on the television, and my granddad, who was hard of hearing, asking for the third time where the morning's newspaper had been put. The house was full of life, and the kitchen table was our meeting place. Here, conversation was as effervescent as the fizzy drinks we guzzled, full of laughter and adventurous stories. Over Sunday roast served on delicately painted floral chinaware, the noise only ever dulled momentarily as plates were filled and appetites satisfied. There seemed to be a magnetism to the food in the way it brought us together. My mother wearing oven mitts, pulling a tray of beef out of the oven, the wafting smells of succulent meat tantalizing our bellies, my mouth watering involuntarily as plump, juicy carrots rolled onto the serving platter. Butter-sautéed green beans and roasted potatoes with crispy skin that made a satisfying crunch, all gobbled down before the next round of tag ejected us kids from the kitchen table chairs. This urban upbringing never gave me much reason to think about where my food had come from or anything else about it, really. My only interest in food was whether it tasted good. For me, food began its life in the brightly coloured packets I swiped off the supermarket shelves while hanging onto the shopping trolley. Though whichever parent was pushing the trolley surreptitiously returned most of my selections. Food was produced under fluorescent lights and the sound of crackly shop speakers. Down the aisles I rolled, mesmerised by the abundance of fruit and vegetables of every shape and imaginable flavour. I was lulled by the shelves of plenty. Back home in the kitchen, I would help unpack the shopping bags, bewildered that my selections had seemingly once again been pilfered by the nifty checkout teenager, but nonetheless happy to stack the pantry cupboard and fridge with another successful haul. Food was always around, within reach, just ready to be plopped into my mouth. I was blasé about it, really, despite Granny's attempts to make me appreciate it more. She would tell me stories of her childhood on her family's farm west of Geelong in Victoria. It was hard to imagine such a life in the countryside or the effort to grow one's dinner. But in times gone by, she said, people thought of food differently and understood its importance. We are lucky to have this meal, Granny would say across the kitchen table, because times can change quickly, so you have to keep alert. She would give her walking stick a loud thump on the floor to emphasize her point. She did this when she was getting serious and I needed to stop and pay attention. Granny learnt about the importance of food during the Great Depression of the 1930s, a period of worldwide social disruption and food insecurity. Many communities lost normal access to food. The painful hollowness of hunger became the puppeteer of many anxious bodies. During the Depression years, Granny took up nursing, tending to the ill and injured. She comforted those in distress and held the hands of weakened bodies. In the hospital ward, she delivered trays of food to each patient, hiding her fear of possible shortages from those under her care. She was around 30 years old when World War II broke out in 1939, a horror that followed on from the Depression. Food rationing became a fact of life in Australia from the 1940s. Meals became fewer and smaller for most people. Tea, sugar, and meat disappeared from shelves, and eggs and milk were distributed under a system of priority for vulnerable communities during periods of shortage. Such commonplace items were regulated and restricted to ensure that each person would receive equal food resources as the war continued. Every person was allowed a certain number of coupons per item. Adults, for example, were assigned £1, 450 grams, of butter per fortnight. This precious staple was used sparingly. Meals were prepared with what food was available and affordable. As soldiers fought one another on battlefronts, people's bellies grew hungry and malnutrition rose around the world. Children and the elderly became vulnerable to nutrient deficiencies, and their weakened bodies made them susceptible to disease. Tuberculosis and rheumatic fever became rife. As the war dragged on, food imports were curtailed in many countries. In Europe, Asia, America, Africa, and Oceania, there was a stark awakening of how brittle the food system really was. The war was a shared social and human experience, and keeping loved ones well fed and safe became central in everyone's minds. People at home in Australia were encouraged to be as self-sufficient as possible, to keep backyard hens for eggs, and to grow their own vegetables. Some public parks were dug up and converted into community vegetable gardens. During this time of disruption, there grew a sense of community through food. Everyone was in this crisis together. Recipes designed to cater for lack of eggs, butter, and common cuts of meat appeared in newspapers and magazines, and animal parts like brains, tripe, liver, and kidneys formed a more significant component of diets. Shortages in food could have propelled greed and ignorance, yet people chose to react instead with compassion and generosity of scarce resources, to be innovative and hopeful, an example of the banding together that is born from times of great need and finding courage during crisis. Respect for food and conscious consumption were ingrained in the generation that lived through the Depression and the war in a way that persisted long after the fighting stopped and official rationing ended. The true value of food, the precious giver of nourishment and health, had been brought to the forefront of Granny's understanding, as it was to all people who learnt about food insecurity via this frightening experience. So it was understandable that food was never wasted in Granny's house. Even when she was in her 80s, 5 decades after the war had ended, no mouldy slice of bread or yellow-tinged tub of yogurt was discarded. Sure, the bread crust of blue fuzz may have been trimmed, but even that was carried straight out to the chicken coop. To where my youthful amazement, old food scraps were converted magically into perfectly shaped brown eggs the next morning by a shed full of clucking feathered magicians. Though this was impressive, I must admit that at this young age, I didn't always see eye to eye with Granny on her mission to let no food go uneaten. I would scrunch up my nose at the pungent smell of acetic acid from fruit becoming overripe in the wooden bowl that sat on her kitchen bench. I dreaded those black bananas being sliced up for my afternoon fruit salad. Despite my protests and pleading to my parents, Granny wouldn't have a bar of it. Always be thankful for your food. Don't ever take it for granted. And with a thump from her walking stick on the floor, the conversation would end. Food turns from a subject of pleasure and complacency to one of concern when my elder brother falls ill. Our childhood escapades end, and a foreboding, unknown ailment begins to cripple my closest game mate. His muscles deteriorate and he drifts in and out of consciousness. He lies in a darkened room in excruciating agony, unable to bear light and noise. Weeks drag into months. My parents frantically try to ease his suffering. I look on silently from a crack in the door as his body wastes away, his moonlight white skin folded into crumpled sheets. Rendering him unable to lift food to his own mouth, the vicious disease strips him of his once healthy, exuberant self. A pale, shrunken frame lies near motionless in his place. It's a long time before specialist doctors diagnose him with an extreme case of chronic fatigue syndrome, the outcome of a virus that invaded his young body. He is admitted to hospital as his condition worsens. In the sterile ward, he sleeps alongside other bed-ridden children, with faces too young to be lined up against white walls, their characters prematurely aged by their conditions. I slowly approach my brother's side, barely recognizing the boy I used to battle with stick swords on the lawn at home. His powerful jousting always disarmed me during our duels. I was too timid, usually fleeing when the game became serious. Now his contorted arms loosely cradle his favorite toy, a small gorilla we bought on a family outing to Melbourne Zoo before he fell ill. The gorilla looks as out of place as my brother in this strange, stark room, its black eyes staring unblinkingly at the ceiling. The smell of hospital bleach makes my head thump. As I sit quietly while my parents read my brother books of princes with enormous courage who overcome great odds. As they tell these stories, my mind wanders, hypnotized by the steady drip from a small, clear bag hanging on a metal hook above my brother's head. Each drip of liquid runs down a long, plastic tube taped to his cheek and disappears into his nose. The doctors tell me the fluid is full of good nutrients and is feeding him so that he will be playing games with me again someday. I trust these experts in white coats and the words they tell me. But the games don't resume anytime soon. I watch red-eyed family members embrace and offer support in a circumstance where no comfort can be found. My parents live in a state of dread that one day they will lose him. I find my mother crying into a basket of dirty laundry in the back room of our house. She can't even catch her breath as she tries to tell me, "It's all right, sweetie. Everything's going to be all right." I run to get my father. They cling together while I watch helplessly, crouched in the corner as they weep among the laundry, until both their shoulders are stained damp with tears. Some weekends, my parents bring my brother home from the hospital for a day. I sit in his wheelchair while he lies on the couch under a quilted blanket. Occasionally, my younger brother clambers up onto the wheelchair with me, and we stretch over the arm rails and heave while turning the large metal wheels. We usually manage a wobbly half circle before flipping the wheelchair over, quickly smacking our hands to our mouths to stifle our gasps and so as not to wake our brother or stress our parents further. In the evenings, when my parents are leaving to take my brother back to his hospital bed for the night, Granny appears at the front door under lamplight with her oversized handbag crooked under her arm and a packet of candied papaya for us to share. My parents' absence as they tend to my brother in hospital means more sleepovers with Granny. It's a chance to practice my dance routines with her and to dress my younger brother in her fox fur coat as my audience. Chopping vegetables and moving pots on and off the stove's flame, Granny bustles noisily around the kitchen while I work on mastering the pirouette in my hot pink lycra leggings. Granny critiques my form while stirring the food with a wooden spoon in a pirouette of its own. The soft bubbling sound of hot stew cooking in the pot is my background music before Granny dishes dinner onto our plates and the kitchen morphs back from dance studio to dining room. Food is life. Granny says, sitting at the kitchen table and ladling another steaming serve into our bowls. She reminds me how lucky we are to eat tasty and healthy food, as not everyone has food in their pantry, and even when some people have food, their bodies reject it. I see the stark contrast in how food nourishes my body and not my brother's. The food I eat gives me strength, sustains my energy, and enables me to go to school. But without the ability to eat meals, my brother has increasingly become a mere shadow of the healthy young boy I once knew. I miss our games and having my parents home at night. During those evenings, after dinner, when my belly is full, I climb onto Granny's lap, nuzzle my face into her bosom, and breathe in her warmth and comfort. She opens up stories of her childhood as though they were books, describing to me her family's farm, where she rode her pony along clear, flowing creeks. Imagining the green fields and the sound of hooves splashing in the water, I pull at threads on her woolen jumper as my eyelids become heavy. The street noise and siren outside the window dissolve into the background, replaced by the whistling call of the barn owl and the bellow of cattle in the valley. Granny tells me about a land that is as fit and vibrant as her younger self. An environment full of secrets and wonder. In these moments, it feels like my brother's illness and the troubles of the past are far away and long ago. And here within my four walls, with Granny's arms wrapped around me and her hands holding mine, my world is safe and always will be. Concepts to cultivate. Food is life. It is the nourishment for our bodies and the stability of our communities. It is the story of our past and the story of our future. 2. Belonging. Wisdom begins in wonder. Aristotle, Metaphysics. 350 BCE. The car door swings open and I tumble out of the back seat along with a pile of suitcases and empty packets of travelling snacks. 12 hours of driving northwest and we finally arrive at our destination. I get to my feet and look around. I have never seen a landscape so enormous. My four walls of suburban familiarity and comfort feel far behind me now. I am 12 years old when my parents purchase a farm. It isn't close to the city of Melbourne or even in the nearby region that is known for producing fine wool and rich landholders. No, my parents have bought a farm in one of Australia's most remote places, in a landscape that greets you with a whack. A fly kick to your chest and it pins you down as its hostage. You don't forget meeting a landscape like that. Undisturbed red sand vistas are peppered with spiny shrubs, as merciless as the intense outback sun that hangs in the sky. Here in the foothills of the Barrier Ranges, in far western New South Wales, kangaroos outnumber people 100 to 1. This place is wild, rugged, and untamed. My parents buy the farm from a man with a smile like a picket fence in a state of disrepair, who, somewhat impressively, fills one toothless gap with rolled tobacco and whistles, "You are my sunshine," from another. Unlike the adults I knew in the city, who stash their intrigue for nature away in a travelling backpack kept in the closet, this antagonist of dentists is in wonderment with his surrounds. His knuckly finger points out things I have never seen in my urban upbringing, telling me which animals have passed from the tracks in the sand and when the rain will fall from the movement of the ants. Naturally, I am suspicious of how he knows what he knows. My parents have no prior farming experience. Their life, like mine, has been metropolitan-based up until this point. But they leap at tasks of fixing fences and painting sheds with admirable gusto, laughing at their own learning mishaps. I am not the only one who is hesitant about this new life, Their Melbourne friends make the occasional snide remark of, "What a dreamy little hobby farm," and "Enjoy your rural holiday." It does nothing to impede their ambition, though. They work out how to drive a tractor to dig dams and spend hours researching livestock and markets. They purchase a truck full of a hardy Egyptian sheep breed called Damara, with doe eyes and large satin ears. It's an uncommon breed for the area, which attracts its own criticism from our farming neighbours, but my parents put their trust in this long-legged, arid-adapted sheep and watched them grow fat grazing in the paddocks. With a philosophy of working with nature and minimising external inputs, they undertake the steps needed to obtain organic certification. They clear away synthetic chemicals, clean the yards of any residue and waste, and care for the sheep in a way that naturally alleviates parasites and diseases. There is a great sense of pride when they finally qualify as organic sheep producers, symbolised by the frame certificate they hang in the study. I learned the term agroecology, the idea that food is produced based on ecological principles, where health and nutrition per hectare is measured rather than yield per hectare. I begin to see my parents as active participants in this landscape, a role I am also being invited to share. Initially, I am hesitant, though, sure that I will get lost or trampled or worst, punched by a kangaroo. So I hover around the house, viewing the outside world from within. I feel safer behind a wall of glass. But seeing the rejuvenated spirit of my parents and their exhausted happiness at the end of long days, I start to wonder what it is they're learning. What do people out here know that I don't yet? The unfamiliar land beckons me to explore it, like the daring older kids at school who know the best adventure lies just out of sight. It wills me to come with it and discover its hidden secrets. And eventually I succumb to curiosity. At daybreak, I wake to a concerto of magpies warbling outside my bedroom window, tie back my unruly long brown hair, wiggle into a cotton shirt, and with a determined grunt, yank on my boots. From the pure morning air filling my lungs as I cross our home lawn heavy with dew, to the dank, earthy smell of mud on the edge of the dam, my senses are tantalized. By the water, I set traps for yabbies and stare in equal amazement and disgust at the awkward crustaceans hanging on to the meaty bone bait. I delicately pluck their powerful pincers from their feast and release them back into the murky depths. I marvel at flocks of thousands of emerald budgerigars and am enchanted by shy wallaroos in the rocky hills. As months and years pass, I cradle newborn lambs in my arms as my parents check their health, and I learn the names of the plants that grow around our farmhouse. As I get to know the world around me, the richness of life bursts forth. The new scenery seems to be doing my elder brother some good as well. He has been in and out of hospital for 8 years. And whether it's the quietness that comes with this rural life, or the distraction, or the fear that if he doesn't recover soon the landscape will devour him, his symptoms seem to be slowly abating. Colour is returning to his cheeks, and although he's unable to exert as much energy as he used to, he's back at my side discovering this new place with me. Together in the paddock, we learn to drive in an old beat-up Suzuki ute with flaking paint and the driver's door held on with baling twine. Barely able to see over the steering wheel, we bump along the corrugated red dirt tracks, grabbing at the gear stick while straining to reach the clutch pedal. With a crunch of metal on metal, a forceful arm jab, and a deafening whir of the engine revving, we jump into a higher gear, our necks whipping at the change in speed. I am beginning to enjoy this place, and as I come to know it, the landscape becomes more than trees and rocks. I see past its tough and enduring facade. I see its fragility. An eggshell of interdependent and symbiotic relationships. An ecosystem molded and looked after by those who live here. What a responsibility, I think. Admittedly, the heart and salt of the earth people out here in this remote landscape do not at first appear to be appropriate for this vital task. Some have more sun wrinkles crisscrossing their face than the landscape has ephemeral creeks that transport life after rain. What an incredible role for someone with a sweat-stained felt hat and a worn-out shirt, I think, contemplating my reflection in the mirror. But as I learn how the hands of rural people nurture the land and the care they take to produce food from it, I see these custodians endeavouring to protect a sacred balance. There is a relationship between them and their environment, an intimacy in the connection of these people with their surrounds. It's common knowledge that farming can be difficult, and so the words resilient and resourceful are often used to describe the people who live on the land, given the variety and number of challenges they face weekly, if not daily. To sustain such a lifestyle suggests deep and strong foundations, underpinnings that are not broken or weathered by trivial matters or even mild inconveniences. I begin to understand that such foundations can only be based on love, as cliche as it seems. For those who choose to live close to the land, their affinity with the natural world is indissoluble and their care for it unwavering. And like them, to my own surprise, I start to fall in love with the land. I feel encircled by things of significance, their meaning sensed rather than grasped, subtle, embedded associations between soil, water, food, health, family, and happiness, where no monetary figure can ever reflect its true value. To live with this land and produce food from it feels like an honour. And as I spend time here, I learn that my family is certainly not the first to feel this way about the land. The closer I look and the more I listen, the rich anthropology etched into the landscape begins to reveal itself to me. I learn with growing fascination about the local Indigenous people who call this place home and whose culture is one of the earliest on Earth. In this region, the Indigenous people are divided into numerous cultural groups: the Bulali and Willakali people, based in and around the barrier ranges, the Barkindji, occupying a large section of the Barker-Darling River frontage. For tens of thousands of years, these people collected bush bananas and fished for river cod, living directly off the land around them. They pulverized wattle seed into flour and cooked fresh meat on fires dotted along the water's edge. These Indigenous people had an affinity with the landscape in which they laughed together, danced in ceremony, built their homes and hunted for food. They were not separate from their surroundings, but part of them. A human-land association shared by Indigenous peoples worldwide. This connection to the environment was so apparent, in fact, that the early European arrivals to the far west of New South Wales noted the deep spiritual relationship with some astonishment. The Barrier Miner newspaper of the 17th of March 1892 includes a telling account of a rainmaking ceremony conducted by the Aboriginal people on Palamica Station during the prevailing drought. The following is a condensed version by historian Richard Kearns. The proceedings involved the patriarchs of the tribe, no women or youth being allowed, sitting in a circle, steadily chanting, "Lo, lo, lo," meaning rain, 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 for 3 days and nights. Into an inflated wallaby skin was placed a quantity of hair cut from the old men's faces to represent black clouds, a bundle of swan's down to symbolize white clouds, two small bones for lightning, and a branch of a shrub known as waterbush. Then followed many hours of chanting, after which the rainmakers performed a circular dance as they approached a small well sunk in the bed of a creek. Veins were opened up, and the blood of the old man spurted into the wallaby skin until it was full. Bleeding was stopped by the application of a plaster of mud and leaves. The skin was placed in the well, and two of the oldest men were forcibly held underwater until they almost drowned. The others filled their mouths with muddy water and squirted it out with great force to represent falling rain. Still chanting, "Lo, lo, lo." They hauled the exhausted old man and covered the well with great reverence. The Palamaka Aboriginals then marched back to the area at which they began the ceremony and prophesied confidently that Big Fellow Rain would come. Big rain did come that year. Water filled the streams and flowed into the river. Wild tomato and native mustard grew in abundance, and the fleshy taproot of the tarvine was pulled from the soil and cooked on campfires. The indigenous people gathered nourishment from their surrounds, taking enough to feed themselves, but rarely ever more. Leaves were pounded to make medicines, and animal skins provided warmth to their bodies. They had an understanding of nature, living by the hours of daylight and the ebb and flow of the seasons. For most of human history, to speak of time was actually to assess the condition of the natural world, which flowers were in bloom, where the migrating animals were feeding, how low the sun sat on the horizon. Our ancestors' time was structured by nature's rhythms and cycles, originating from Earth's tilt and rotation. To this day, the sun is buried deep in our human biology, as we rise and sleep with circadian rhythms, betraying our identity as animals deeply embedded in a planet turning on its axis. And how foolish we would be to think this untrue, to cut our own cord from Mother Nature and to forcibly disconnect others who remained cognizant of our dependence. But the growing global population over the past few centuries and white colonization of other areas disrupted and displaced Indigenous people who lived within the natural world. Europeans arrived in the district west of the Barker-Darling River in the mid-1800s, assuming control of vast expanses of land and destroying much of the fabric of the tribal systems over the ensuing years. Many traditional camping and hunting grounds were taken over, and Indigenous people on sheep farms soon became dependent on issues of flour, meat, tea, and sugar, usually in exchange for labour. By the early 1900s, either voluntarily or by government action, most of the Barker-Darling Aboriginal people had been relocated to or near the small river townships. Many of the tribal identities were lost with time, together with thousands of years of customs and beliefs from undisturbed existence. There was both a casual, uncaring, and unpremeditated destruction of Indigenous lifestyles and cultures, and brutality and harsh treatment towards these people who looked, spoke, and lived differently from the colonizers. Thereafter occurred the gradual loss and suppression of people who had a profound respect for the natural world, from which they did not see themselves as separate. This coincided with an influx of new arrivals who had an eagerness to conquer new lands and often held both a domineering and exploitive mentality. In the vast Australian outback, the separation of self from the environment is a treacherous mistake. An unforgiving sun can make quick work of those inexperienced in locating water and food. Captain Charles Sturt and his party were the first Europeans to penetrate the far west region of New South Wales.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.